So the image we received was basically a radio wavelength sort of image that we mapped onto the visible spectrum. So it's sort of like the infrared, where you can see the color temperatures of things, and you map it into visible. So we mapped the brightness of the radio waves that were coming at us onto the visible to be able to get the sense of that picture. So during a star's life, it's undergoing fusion and it's giving off energy. When the star dies out, it's running out of fuel, the fuel that it uses to create the fusion, and so the star is going to collapse. If the star is massive enough, it's going to have an explosion, and when it collapses, you get something like a neutron star, very dense spinning object. If it's even more massive, then it collapses and we've got nothing to stop it. There's nothing to stop the collapse, so all that mass is getting packed into a smaller and smaller spot, and we call this a singularity. We call this all this almost infinite density of stuff that packs down into this object, and we're going to call that a black hole. So a black hole has this radius out from it, it's called the event horizon. And the black hole is a massive object in space-time, in Einstein's general relativity. It's warping the space. And it's warping it so much that at that point, light itself can't even escape from the center of this black hole, from inside. So outside of it, light can escape and stuff can escape, but inside, nothing can escape. So that's the event horizon of this. Now, the black hole has mass. The black hole can also spin. And we can tell the difference between something that's spinning or something that's not spinning. Even the Earth has a very weak gravitational field, relatively speaking, but we can tell that the Earth is spinning and detect the general relativity consequences of a spinning Earth versus just a mass Earth, and here's the satellite out here that's detecting the general relativity. So we're looking at the center of another galaxy. We've got a black hole at the center of our galaxy too. And I'm going to use a lacrosse ball as an example. The lacrosse ball, if I put it close to my eye, that's subtending a big angle. There's a big angle to this lacrosse ball. Move it farther away, it's going to be a smaller angle. So if I take the lacrosse ball, the human eye could see the lacrosse ball maybe 2.5 lacrosse fields away. The Hubble telescope could see the lacrosse ball if it were, say, the distance out from the Hubble down to the ground, it could see a lacrosse ball. This telescope is going to, this telescope array, can see things where if you put the lacrosse ball on the moon, you'd be able to detect the lacrosse ball, as opposed to if I put two objects, two lacrosse balls next to each other, you'd say, oh, there's two. So how do you get this resolution? We've got an array of telescopes. You see these radio telescope arrays with a bunch of different telescopes. You chain them all together. You connect them so that all the signals that come in, you time them, nice atomic clock timing, very fine resolution timing, and then collect all this data together. You can assemble the general picture, what everybody saw of that particular object. Well, now we're chaining around the globe. We're going to put telescope arrays around the whole globe and all pointing at the same object and all chained together. Some of these places are so remote, they're storing the data on hard drives with the atomic clock timing to keep the resolution, but they're storing them on hard drives because they can't, there's no Wi-Fi connection, there's no fiber optic connection. So they're driving these hard drives around to get them out somewhere where they can collect the data together. So this stuff was taken 2 years ago in April, 4 day period. They collected all this data from all these different telescopes and have been assembling it and working with that data ever since. So what we're looking at here, this is the image that was released except without the blue dot on it. That I added the blue dot. So the image released was this. This is the radio wavelength information that came to us. And then if it's brighter, it's a stronger signal. It's a more intense signal. And if it's dimmer, it's a less intense signal. So this is the center of the galaxy, and there's these huge jets coming out, one on either side. This jet's more easy to see because it's coming toward us, so it's a little bit brighter. And so the jets are coming out. That tells us it's spinning. So the black hole spinning, and what we think is it's spinning in the sense of spinning sort of clockwise this way and tilted away from our perspective. So if it's spinning that way, that's going to put a jet out either end. That's also going to make the stuff that's down below spinning toward us. And toward us makes it brighter. So above us, it's a little bit dimmer going away from us, a little bit brighter going toward us. So this gives us a good confirmation of what we already know, this to be a spinning black hole based on the jets, that, oh yeah, brighter coming toward us would make sense, and then dimmer going away from us. So this sort of asymmetry that we see is basically what we're looking at. The blue dot that I put in the middle, that's about where the event horizon would be. And what we're actually seeing is all the darkness around it. So the light coming from the black hole, if this is the black hole in front, and so light coming straight from the event horizon, we're not going to see that light, right? Light can't escape. But light coming from around the back behind the black hole also gets trapped by the black hole. And so what we're really seeing is the unfolding of the back end of the black hole. That's that, if you imagine curling this up and having the stuff where you can't see this, you can't see the stuff around here, all that stuff sort of curling up because of the curvature of space, it's curling around. So we're seeing more of the black hole, really not seeing, more of the black hole than we expect, than we should just from the event horizon. So this part of the black hole is sort of peeling up around. And then the edge of this is now, this could be the accretion disk, this all the stuff that's swirling into the black hole, giving off all this radiation, giving off all this heat. That could be the swirling of the accretion disk, or it could be light orbiting around the black hole, and we're just seeing the brightness of the light orbit. Most likely that's the accretion disk, but we're seeing more of the black hole than just the event horizon, because it sort of peels off around, we're seeing around the back side of it because of the curvature of space. So in my astronomy class, we've got March of Technology is my phrase, and I run that all the way through the course. We start with telescopes to see moons around Jupiter, and that was the most we could see at the time. Then we started seeing planets around other stars. Then we started seeing black holes colliding. So only 4 years ago, we saw black holes colliding, or rather, we got the evidence of black holes colliding. This is the next step, to image. We've got images of planets around stars, and we now have an image of a black hole. What's the next step beyond this? Two black holes colliding and we're watching it. Oh man, that would be sweet. So the resolution of our telescope, this telescope array, is how many members of the telescope do we have out there? How many groups, how many arrays? The more of them we put out there, the better the signal we get. The bigger that array we've got, the bigger the aperture of our telescope that we're using, that's going to give us better resolution. Plus the timing, plus the ability for each individual scale telescope to measure better frequencies, better wavelengths of light, all of that's going to improve the technology. And we're seeing the improvement. I think we had our fifth or sixth black hole merger just announced. We now have the first candidate. You know they're going to look at the center of our galaxy to look at that one because it's an even bigger black hole signature than this one here. And the more resolution, the more telescopes that come online, and they've got plans for the next couple of years, more and more telescopes, bigger aperture, more resolution, better pictures.